take the end of all time. Someone to understand you like I do. You'll never find the rhythm, the rhyme, all the magic we shared, just us two. Someone who needs you like I do. You'll never see what you found in me. You keep searching and searching your whole life through. Oh, I don't wish you no bad luck, baby.
Assim, e passou, nem parou, mas olhou só pra mim. Se voltar, vou atrás, vou pedir, vou falar, vou contar que o amor foi feitinho pra dar. Olha, é como o verão, quente o coração, salta de repente para ver a menina que vem. Sempre tem esse mar no olhar, e vai ver, tem que ser, nunca tem quem amar. Hoje sim, diz que sim, já cansei de esperar, nem parei, nem dormi, só pensando em me dar. Peço, mas você não vem. Vem, deixo então, falo só, digo ao céu, mas você vem.
Vai ver, tem que ser, nunca tem quem amar. Hoje
que sim, diz que sim. Já cansei de esperar, nem parei, nem dormi, só pensando em me dar. Peço, mas você não vem. Vem, deixa então, falo só, digo ao céu, mas você vem. Sometimes in life you feel the fight is over, and it seems as though the ride is on the wall. Superstar, you finally made it, but once your picture becomes tainted, it's what they call the rise and fall.
I always said that I was gonna make it, now it's plain for everyone to see. This game I'm in don't take no prisoners, just casualties. I know that everything is gonna change, even the friends I knew before me go. But this dream is the life I've been searching for. Started believing that I was the greatest, my life was never gonna be the same. Cause with the money came a different status, that's when things changed. Now I'm too concerned with all the things I own, blinded by all the pretty girls I see. I'm beginning to go.
No rewind. Welcome to the 2018 British Columbia Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Please join us this evening as we celebrate the rich history of hockey in British Columbia. As part of this evening's ceremony, we will introduce the Jameson, Carter, Ashley, Hockey Now, Pascal, and Quinn Awards winners, and the induction of this year's entrants into the British Columbia Hockey Hall of Fame, the 1979-80 Burnaby Lakers, Jerry Sillars, Scott Hannon, and Willie Mitchell. An important part of the evening is to bring awareness for Canuck Place in Vancouver. This hospice serves children and their families from all over British Columbia during a very difficult time in their lives. Thank you to all for attending this evening, and we hope you will enjoy the British Columbia Hockey Hall of Fame induction ceremony. Now please, put your hands together and welcome your host for tonight's ceremonies, Bernie Pascal.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to a very special induction ceremony, the 25th anniversary, a salute to the BC Hockey Hall of Fame. It's especially gratifying, yes, give a nice round of applause, especially gratifying to see so many past inductees in attendance. They're here to help us welcome the class of 2018. Now, we're all cognizant of the great support and the history of hockey in British Columbia, and we're pleased to acknowledge our list of sponsors, including Boston Pizza, Red Rooster, Rogers Sportsnet, Okanagan Hockey Group, the Vancouver Canucks, the Penticton Lakeside Resort, Molson Canadian, WHL, BC Hockey, and others. And a big thank you to you, the hockey fans. Give yourselves a round of applause. A special welcome to members of the selection committee. Your commitment and dedication to the induction process is valued and much appreciated. We'd like to acknowledge those we lost in 2018. The Humboldt Broncos are constantly in our prayers. It was a major tragedy. The hockey world has provided amazing support to the Broncos and their families. Canucks public address announcer John Ashbridge passed away in 2018, and John will be missed. And a valued member of the BCHL and hockey in British Columbia, the popular owner of the Vernon Vipers, Dr. Duncan Ray, passed away this past year. Duncan was a proud inductee of the BC Hockey Hall of Fame, and as a tribute to Duncan and his family, we look back at the video presented the night of his induction in 2011.
The BCHL has produced many exceptional players, coaches, and executives over the years. One of the leading franchises in that regard is the Vernon Vipers.
Trying to get those forehand off the body, score!
The Vernon franchise is very successful on the ice, but also keenly involved in off-ice activity as well, under the ownership and presidency of Dr. Duncan Ray. Paint the Rink Pink is one of those initiatives undertaken by the Vipers. It's the team's way of giving back to the community, joining the fight against cancer. The Vernon Vipers have raised literally thousands of dollars in this charitable endeavor. The Vipers have enjoyed immense success in the BCHL under the guidance of Duncan Ray. Since purchasing the Vipers in 1992, Vernon has been to the BCHL Championship 11 times, winning six BCHL Championships and 4 RBC Cups. 1996, at the inaugural RBC Cup, Vernon beat Malfort, Saskatchewan 2-0. 1999, John Bradley was named top defenseman as Vernon beat Charlottetown in the championship game. In 2009, Vipers won the RBC Cup with a 2-0 win over Humboldt, Andrew Hammond recording the shutout. That was followed in 2010. Vipers went 3-1 in the round robin, leading to the championship, and they beat Dauphin 8-1 to win the coveted Canadian Junior A championship and the RBC Cup. Vernon Vipers' community involvement also includes sharing their on-ice expertise with minor hockey players. Skate with the Vipers is a popular and highly anticipated event. Fun is the key ingredient in events like this. The players mingle and meet with young fans, sign autographs, and basically promote the overall great image of the BCHL Vipers. Duncan Ray has been an integral part of that process. He's also a strong supporter of combining education and hockey. He takes extreme pride in seeing aspiring hockey players being offered education scholarships to enhance their academic careers. Numerous graduates of the Vipers have gone on to excel in the NHL. That's a statistic the franchise can be especially proud of, along with the fact many have pursued and been successful in other areas of business and life. This past spring, coaches, office staff, and players of the Vernon Vipers held a surprise retirement party for the popular owner of the BCHL team. A cake, representative of his dentistry career, definitely offered a unique and humorous touch to the festivities as he says goodbye to his day job. Giving back to the community, having fun, developing outstanding young men, gaining the respect of his staff and the respect of his junior hockey peers quickly spells out the character and integrity of this exceptional junior hockey team owner. The BC Hockey Hall of Fame proudly welcomes 2011 inductee Dr. Duncan Ray.
Our thoughts and prayers are with the Duncan Ray family and with all those we lost in 2018. So many BC teams, players, and coaches enjoyed success this past year. Congratulations to all of them. Stanley Cup champion, Washington Capitals, with a BC player on the roster, Brent Connolly. RBC Cup champions, Chilliwack Chiefs. Cyclone Taylor Cup, Richmond Sockeyes. World Juniors, won and led by their captain from BC, Dylan Dubé, as they won a gold medal. The women's team won silver at the Olympics. 15 BCHL players won gold at the World Junior A Challenge. 7 BCHL players were selected at the NHL Draft. Several BC players selected from the WHL at the NHL entry draft, and so many other great hockey achievements in 2018. We salute them all, and it's especially gratifying tonight to have so many members of the Vancouver Canuck alumni, the best in the NHL, with us this evening. Give them all a round of applause. Tonight, the 25th annual induction, and I'm proud to say I've attended all of them. A salute to the 2018 inductees of the BC Hockey Hall of Fame. Enjoy the evening. It promises to be fun, and definitely with Dennis Hall coming up a little later, the emphasis will be fun. We're pleased to announce our new broadcast partners, Rogers Sportsnet. Scott Moore and company, thank you. Now, to direct the proceedings the rest of the way, let's welcome our master of ceremonies for the evening from Sportsnet 650, Joey Kenward and Perry Sulkowski.
Thank you, Bernie. You know, Perry didn't grow up in British Columbia. I'm born and raised in BC.
You're throwing me under the bus right away.
No, not yet. Bernie looks the same as when I was watching him when I was 5 years old. And that's no joke. No joke.
I'll say this. I didn't grow up in BC. This has been a second home for me. In fact, I got married 24 years ago, about 3 minutes down the road at the Penticton Yacht Club. I got divorced 19 years ago at the law firms of London Oak. So, Joey, there are some special memories to me. And you mentioned Bernie Pascal.
Hang on, before we talk about that, 24 years ago, we talk about Bernie, what he looked like that long ago. Take a look on the screen right now. Perry mentioned it with his wife, Catherine, 24 years ago. I think, look at that.
Oh, you guys doing this kind of stuff? And I was joking about the divorce. She's here with me today. I tell you, I came here in 1991, and I see a lot of familiar faces because that was when I got the invite. I was doing a sports program in Edmonton, and I got the invite to come play in the Andy Moog and Special Friends. And I'm sure, round of applause for anybody who's played in that here. Most of us have. And when I met Bernie, so I came here, and it's for Special Olympics, met so many great people, and I look, and I'm intimidated, and I was doing the 6 o'clock, Bernie's at BCTV, and I see someone over there, and I see someone with a terrible golf swing, and gangly, and awkward, doesn't look coordinated, and wasn't making a whole lot of sense when they were speaking, and I'm walking over, and that's when Bernie said, Perry, have you met John McKeachy? So that was my first first introduction to meeting John McKeachy and the legends that were BCTV.
So that's 21 years ago. We saw what Perry looked like 24 years ago. Take a look at what Perry looked like on that day when he came to the Andy Moog golf tournament. That's Perry up in the top left corner with those sparkling white shorts.
Joey, I didn't know.
No, you didn't.
Here's the deal. So I apologize whoever played with us in 1991. If you saw that picture on the bottom right, because no one knew who I am and who I was, and
bring that previous photo back up so we can see.
Look who I'm playing with. I was considered a half celebrity, and Paul Kariya at the bottom right was the other half, so we could make one celebrity for the poor saps who had to play with us. So in discussion with Andy, who's not here, I texted and I said, listen, now that I'm the morning host at Sportsnet 650 at Rogers in Vancouver, if you started that tournament up again, what kind of status would I have now that I'm a big morning show host on the radio? And he said, you probably wouldn't be able to caddy. So the career hasn't gone the right way. Things worked out well for Paul. But as Joey said, I didn't know you'd do that. Some special memories, and it's great to come here and see what this building has turned into. And I've always known through my good friend Scott Carter, you guys have done some incredible things here, and you should be proud of what the BC Hockey Hall of Fame is all about.
All right, so we've got a lot to get through that you're fully aware. Just by a show of hands, who's here for the first time? Who's never been to this? Wow, awesome. Thank you all for coming. Thank all of you as well for returning. Before we get through our list of inductees for the class of 2018, Bernie mentioned we want to recognize a number of individuals who were honored with awards or bursaries. We had a luncheon at the hall at the South Okanagan Events Center earlier on. And for those of you that might not be aware of what the awards are or the recipients, we're going to tell you briefly. The hall every year has an award named in the memory of a longtime supporter of minor hockey, not only here in Penticton, but around British Columbia. Dunk Jameson was a lifetime member both of the Penticton Minor Hockey Association as well as being a founding member of the BC Hockey Hall of Fame Society. Now, this award goes to an individual who exemplifies their dedication to and the enjoyment of the sport. He hails from the small community of Falkland. He helped jumpstart two Junior B franchises in the North Okanagan, first of all in Enderby, then in Armstrong. Along the way, he's helped grow the sport in different capacities. He's been a referee in chief. He has been a master course instructor for BC Hockey and Hockey Canada's safety programs. He's also been president of the North Okanagan Minor Hockey Association, and just recently he's taken on the role as chairman of the board for BC Hockey, now into their 100th year. How about a congratulations as the BC Hockey Hall of Fame presents Bill Green with the 2018 Dunk Jameson Award. Bill, please stand up. Thank you very much, making the trek all the way down from Falkland. Thank you. No, he got it early. Hockey Now recognizes the importance of supporting, promoting, and giving back to the community around our province. And every year, the Minor Hockey Player of the Year Award program honors individuals who exemplify sportsmanship and leadership, their hockey abilities, and their performance, not only on the ice, but in the classroom. This year's recipient comes off a very productive year with the Bantam Prep Squad at Yale Hockey Academy in his hometown of Abbotsford. In 30 games playing in the sports school regular season, he put up 20 goals and 48 assists. In three playoff games, he was pretty good. 3 goals, 3 helpers. He also had the chance to play for his club's midget team. This past May, he was selected into the Western Hockey League Bantam Draft, just one of 3 players from our province to be taken in the first round. He was picked by the Brandon Wheat Kings. He's set to play midget hockey next season and has a very, very bright future ahead in store in the sport. The BC Hockey Hall of Fame congratulates Jake Chason on being the recipient of the BC Hockey Now Minor Hockey Player of the Year. Did Jake make it up? And if Jake's here, can you please stand? Thank you, Jake. I know you weren't able to make it for the lunch. Great to see you. Congratulations. The Patricia Carter Bursary is presented every year to a young player looking to advance their education, who at the same time has shown perseverance and dedication on the ice. This award is presented in the memory of Patricia Carter, the first ever of the BC Hockey Hall, first woman ever of the BC Hockey Hall of Fame Society and longtime supporter of hockey in this province. This year's recipient was born here in Penticton, eventually moved away up to the North Okanagan and then down to the Lower Mainland. He played Bantam and Midget hockey in the Lower Mainland before returning home to play for the Penticton Vs. He spent 1 year in the BCHL here before being traded to the Surrey Eagles. Along the way, he's represented Canada West at the World Junior A Championships, and he was one of just 7 players from our province to play in that tournament in Bonnyville, Alberta. Last December, he received a scholarship offer from Quinnipiac University in Connecticut, which is one of the top NCAA hockey programs in New England. The BC Hockey Hall of Fame congratulates Desi Burghardt on being the recipient of the Patricia Carter Award. Desi, stand up, take a bow. All the way in the back. Congratulations, Desi.
Nice job, Desi. Desi, Brad's son? Brad there? Is he still working at the Capilano Club? You want to go golfing with Joey and I there if your dad will let us on the course?
Yeah, you do.
Jerry, you want to come? Jerry, can we get on the cap class? Jerry, silly, that's what we'll do. We'll go golfing there. Congratulations to all those award winners. Time for the Bernie Pascal Media Award. We've talked about Bernie. Bernie gave me wonderful advice. I wish I would have listened when I first reached out to him in 88. What I should do in the business, he said, if you got into mortgage brokering and moved to Vancouver, you'd do well. I think the real estate market is going to boom. I stayed with this. Bernie has done so much. He is a member of the BC Hockey Hall of Fame. It recognizes the individual in the media who demonstrates commitment and dedication to the promotion within the game of hockey, and it is named after Bernie Pascal. And if memory serves, the gentleman beside me here was the winner last year, Joey Kenward. One of BC's greatest sportscasters is Bernie Pascal, who did so much locally, nationally, and internationally. Bernie was inducted into the BC Hockey Hall of Fame in 2006, and this award has been presented in his name for the last 5 years. This year's recipient is a longtime BC Hockey League broadcaster by the name of Dan Marshall. He's a native of Coquitlam. Dan started covering the BCHL right here in Penticton with the Panthers and then the Vs for 7 seasons before he relocated to Nanaimo. 10 years later, Dan has established himself as a fixture on the Vancouver Island sports scene. He has been the radio play-by-play voice of the Nanaimo Clippers broadcast, in addition to being a news and sports reporter on radio station 106.9, The Wolf. In 2012 and in 2015, he received the BCHL Broadcaster of the Year honor, and today the BC Hockey Hall of Fame is proud to present Dan Marshall with the 2018 Bernie Pascal Media Award. And not surprising when you have this kind of work ethic, Dan could not be here tonight because he is also the voice of the Timbers of lacrosse, and he is working a game tonight in Nanaimo. But how about a round of applause for everything Dan has done in his broadcasting? The Pat Quinn Coach Award. Where's Callie? I haven't seen Callie for literally 15 years. Callie Quinn, everybody, in the far corner, representing the Quinn family here.
Sandra's here.
Sandra's, oh, I didn't see Sandra. Where is Sandra? Sandra and Callie, thank you for coming. Every year, the Hockey Hall of Fame presents an award named in memory of the greatest teachers and the greatest game has ever had in this province, and it is named after former Canucks player, head coach, GM, and president Pat Quinn. Now, the Coach Award is given to an individual, regardless of their level of coaching, who helps and shares excellence by educating players in the sport of hockey. Born in Summerlin, Tim Coughlin grew up playing hockey in the Okanagan, played parts of two seasons in the BC Junior Hockey League in the early 1980s with the Shuswap Totems, and after playing at the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point program in the mid-1980s, he signed a pro contract with the Vancouver Canucks in 1989. Once his career was over in 1992, he returned to his former school to be an assistant coach for two seasons before becoming the head coach, the bench boss at Norbert College in Wisconsin. He's led that program to being one of the best Division III schools in the United States. How good, you wonder? Since joining St. Norbert 25 years ago, Coughlin's program has appeared in 12 Frozen Four tournaments and have been crowned national champions five times, including this past season, as the Green Knights posted an overall record of 27-4-1. Last year, he was inducted into the Wisconsin Hockey Hall of Fame, and this year, rightly so, into the BC Hockey Hall of Fame. Proud to present Tim Coughlin with the 2018 Pat Quinn Coach Award. He has made the journey all the way from Wisconsin, so we'd love to have him come up here and say a few words, everybody.
Is there someone here?
Typical media guys, they want a nod for the speech. So, well done, boys. You got a nod. There you go. First of all, thank you. It's certainly humbling. It's an honor and a privilege to be here on behalf of my family, who could not make the trip at this particular time. And to Callie and Mrs. Quinn, I'm so grateful and thankful to be here with the name recognition of Pat Quinn. It meant a lot to me growing up, and it means a lot to my mother, who passed away in 2010. She was a big Pat Quinn fan. So this room is filled with legends in the National Hockey League, Stanley Cup winners, and people that will be in the Hall of Fame, but none bigger than the name of Pat Quinn. So this award means everything to me, and I appreciate that very much. To the BC Hockey Hall of Fame Selection Committee, thank you for considering Tim Coughlin for this award, and certainly for all the work that you do for everybody that has ever been in this room before. Congratulations to the class of 2018, all well-deserved, all well-earned, and everybody in this room appreciates what all of you have done. Thank you to my family who's here from Summerland, from Vancouver, my surrogate parents from Salmon Arm, the Carters. We appreciate all that folks do to help all of us as hockey players across the board. And what I didn't tell my sister Shirley, who today, by the way, on the 20th, it's her birthday. So what I said is, I'm coming for your birthday. I'm gonna buy you like cocktails at Red Rooster last night, and I'm gonna take you out to lunch with the rest of our family at noon at the SOC today. And then we're going, like, or at the hotel. Then we're gonna come back to the hotel tonight, and we're gonna have a huge ceremony, and I'm gonna throw a big party. Shirley, this is all for you. So thank you. BC Hockey and the BCHL has always been a big part of my life. Grew up in Summerland, as you've heard. I played in the league for 3 years in Salmon Arm, and that was we know it as the Brett Hull era, because Brett kind of ruled the roost. And the year that he scored 105, my old general manager from Salmon Arm is here somewhere, Gordy McIntosh. I don't know what my plus minus was that year, but Brett had 105, so I couldn't have been a good spot at that point. Coaching now at St. Norbert for the past 25 seasons, I'm very proud to say, as a BC resident for a long time, that we have had over 55 players from the BC Hockey League play on our roster at one time or another. And that means a lot to me because I was given the same opportunity. And the BC Hockey League continues to be a premier league all across North America. You guys are doing it right. John Grisdale's done a fantastic job. This league is in very good spot, so we appreciate that. I'll just highlight a couple of guys from the province. 1999 at St. Norbert, Rob Smiley was the National Player of the Year, and he's from Richmond. In 2006, we had Spencer Carberry from Victoria play for us, came out of Penticton. He's now the head coach in the American Hockey League of the Hershey Bears. So continues to do great things on everybody's behalf. In 2008, we won our first national championship. Kyle Jones, Delta, British Columbia, National Player of the Year. And even just this year, we just won our fifth national championship. And we had a player from Fred Harbinson. Freddie's in the room. I've known Freddie forever. Freddie is one of the elite junior coaches anywhere in the world. And Freddie has done a great job. Chris Rigas, who played here, was on our 2018 national championship team. So to think that the BC Hockey League has an impact, it's had a huge impact on what we do at St. Norbert College and what I've done in my career. So indeed, I'm a blessed man. The game has been very good to me. I appreciate that. I won a title as a player, as an assistant coach, 5 titles as a head coach. I've been the national coach of the year in the United States 2 times, and nothing, I can promise you as I stand today, nothing compares to being honored in the name of Pat Quinn, Kelly, and to Mrs. Quinn. I'm so grateful, I'm thankful, I'm appreciative to be here. God bless you all, thank you.
Congratulations, well said. As Bernie mentioned earlier, Boston Pizza has been a proud title sponsor for the induction ceremony for the BC Hockey Hall of Fame, and this year is no different. Every year, Boston Pizza does great work in all of their communities around the province, helping raise money that goes directly to the Canucks for Kids Fund. It helps out beneficiaries such as BC's Children's Hospital, the Canuck Place Children's Hospice, and the Canucks Autism Network. The founder of Boston Pizza, the pride of Penticton, Jim Treliving, along with his recently retired chairman, George Melville, couldn't be with us tonight, but they pass along their regards, their congratulations. They've been amazing supporters of the Hall of Fame for quite some time. But I want to welcome up Jean Whitaker from Boston Pizza. She's the director of marketing for Western Canada to say a few words, and as well want to welcome up former Canucks goaltender and BC Hockey Hall of Fame member Kirk McLean for a special presentation. Come on up, guys.
Awesome. Thanks, Joey. Hi, everyone. On behalf of Jim and George, our local franchisees, and everyone at Boston Pizza, we're very proud to be able to support the BC Hockey Hall of Fame and the Canucks for Kids Fund. We love being a part of the community here in the Okanagan, and we love being a part of the hockey community throughout BC. A big congratulations to the inductees and award winners tonight. I think it's a tremendous recognition of your accomplishments, so congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you to Boston Pizza. Jim and George have been great. One of the things when you came and played years ago in Andy Moog's Boston Pizza, you got the terry cloth robes, the golf bags. I still have my Boston Pizza watch from 1993. It's broken, but as I am Polish and as the Polish proverb goes, even a watch that is broken is right twice a day. So I always get excited around 10 o'clock in the morning and at night when I look at the watch and everything is in control. Before we get underway to honoring the inductees, we want to raise some money here with a live auction. And Dennis is ahead. There'll be an awful lot of laughs ahead. I saw everyone walking around. The great thing, you come to Penticton, you look at the silent auction items and the uniforms that we have here. They are second to none. Be aware that that'll be open till 9 o'clock. So if you have your eye on something, make sure you get over there to put in your final bids. But we've got some wonderful live auction items, and we've got a wonderful auctioneer. He's part of the Okanagan. Dixon Ward played over 500 games in the NHL as well. Of course, time in Toronto. Buffalo was where he had a good run. L.A. His best years were in Vancouver. I think his first year in Vancouver, 50-plus points. That was 1992. So at that point, Dixon in his prime. And that's when the Roxy nightclub was probably in its prime as well. So ironically, this night makes sense for Dixon to come up on stage because his memories are like this evening in Penticton, a little bit hazy. But we will get through that. Please welcome your auctioneer for tonight, Dixon Ward. Dixie, where you at?
Ready to go? Thanks, Steve Armitage.
Yeah.
I'd like to thank Bruce Judd for throwing that on my lap 8 minutes ago and say you're doing the auction. cut it out. My best years were not in Vancouver, by the way. They were in Buffalo. I was telling someone this story today. And if anybody saw the picture I had the other day in the Roxy car, anybody that seen that picture, that's the greatest picture of all time. On behalf of the Okanagan Hockey Group, Andy Oakes, our president, who is an integral part of what we do here with this event and our sponsorship, and the rest of our company, we are thankful that you're all here and congratulate all of the inductees and all of the past inductees that have attended this weekend. Last night in Red Rooster was a wonderful night. Tonight's even better. We get to hear from those who have earned the right to be here, and for all of you that are here for the first time, everybody that stands on the stage and accepts an award has earned the right tenfold, and we're proud of all of you, and we're proud to be part of it. The auction, and we're gonna get through this quick. I want you all to dig deep and understand that this is just money. You can all make it back on Monday, so spend it and spend it freely. There's a lot of good stuff here, and we're going to go through it quick. Where's my guys on the floor? Grant's over there. Where's Jimmy? Jimmy there. There. So put your hands high, bid high. Don't tell your wives if you've overspent, because they, if they're not here, they're on Amazon right now, overspending already. First auction, Ogopogo Wine Tour. And part of this chicken scratch that Bruce did for me has got the details. Includes a $100 lunch for four people at Zaya's Restaurant in Summerland, two rooms lodging at Summerland Resort, including two spa packages at the Skaha Day Spa. Is that what it says, Skaha? Anyway, some spa. Local lounge appetizer for four people. Two massages, two pedicures. Value is $2,000. We want to start at $1,000. Who's got $1,000 for this Ogopogo Wine Tour? Spa package, massage, pedicure, dinner. We got $1,000? We got $1,000 over there. All right, Grant, anybody got $1,200? I can't see anything, so you're gonna have to talk. $1,000 over there, $1,200. $1,100. Let's see if we can get to $1,200 and we'll sell it for $1,200. Who's got $1,200? Get there for $1,200. Come on, Ronnie.
Yeah,
1,200 for Ronnie is sold. Thank you, Ronnie. You're the best. Don't worry, I'm going to sell season tickets to the White Rock Whalers coming up. How many seats in that rink? 300? We sell 100 packages for 13. Not too many people in the rink. Anybody want season tickets to the White Rock Whalers? White Rock Whalers. Ronnie Patterson's new junior B team. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be awesome. Okay, the next event, or the next, not event, but the next item up for sale, Area 27. For those of you who don't know, Area 27 is a racetrack out here in the South Okanagan. It's a real race car experience. You bring your own car. There's cars there. It's really a cool thing. We have a pro experience package in a Porsche provided for you at Area 27. Two people, two racing jackets, two racing hats, and two credentials. Whatever that means, you probably get a tag around that says, I'm part of Area 27. It's a $1,000 value, but it's an unbelievable experience to ride a... Yeah, it's a sick experience. If you like roller coasters, this is on steroids. Oh, Bruce did give me something. It says Area 27. Thanks, Bruce. Appreciate that. It's a country club style racetrack designed by Formula One world champion Jacques Villeneuve, for those of you who don't know. Now, in his second year of operations, the track has 300 members and is working on additions, a high-speed go-kart track, blah, blah, blah. Pro rides in an exclusive hot lap experience. The participant will be driven for 5 laps on the 4.83 kilometer track by one Area 27 professional. So you don't actually get to drive the Porsche. Is that what you're saying? Well, I could have got a Porsche for you that you could drive it yourself. liability is shmiability. Ask Larry Lund. He ran a hockey school forever. He never worried about liability. Where are you, Larry? Thanks for that. Two authentic jackets, you get a lanyard. That's what the credentials are, the lanyard. That's important. So we got a $1,000 value. Who wants to rip around the track 150 miles an hour with a pro driver? $1,000 value, let's start at $500 for two people. We got 500? Oh, you're starting at 750, John. 750, John Shannon. Who's going to outbid John Shannon? Let's get $1,000 out of this deal. Andy Oakes, $1,000. Craig McEwen, for Christ's sake, he just signed the Vancouver Giants with Sportsnet 650. Let's get $1,500 out of that deal. $1,500 for Craig McEwen. That a boy. You put Hershey in there, your red hair will be sticking straight up. No question about it. $1,500, Craig McEwen. $1,750. Where do we got $1,750? Really fast Porsche. I know a lot of people in Petek have never seen a Porsche before, but they're really sweet. They got rounded on the back. They're kind of cool. Ask Scott Hannon. He's got 3 in San Jose in his garage for sure. 1,055 games. He's got 3 Porsches for sure. 1,500, Craig McEwen going once. Somebody beat him out. Don't beat him out. We want to see him pay it. Sold to Craig McEwen, $1,500. Way to go, Craig. Thank you very much, Craig McEwen. I love this job. Vancouver Canucks package. Who's here for the Canucks as a decision maker? Kirk, are you the guy? You're going to make decisions? We'll just text Trevor and say this is what's happening. That's awesome. What do we want to do with the Vancouver Canucks package? We might have bunk beds in the locker room by the time we're done. Where's Patty O'Neill? You can figure us out in the back in the equipment room. Hey, right by the beer fridge in the equipment room, we can put bunk beds. You can stay for 3 days. You get 2 games right on the bench with a jacket with Patty O'Neill. Sharpen a few skates. Sorry, Brock, I only got 2 edges out of 4 sharpened today, but hey, don't turn right. Two regular season game tickets in the Vancouver Canucks GM box. So there's a hell of a lot of great conversation with the GM. So if you have a kid that's 17, 18, it might be a good buy for you. Take him late. Take him late. He'll be good. In addition to those tickets, you get dinner for two in the captain's room pregame. Alcohol not included, but since Trevor's not here, we'll include alcohol as much as you can drink. Top shelf alcohol as well. No problem. Hey, Schnepsy, we'll bring a case of Crown Royal in if you want it. 2 Canucks jerseys, winner choice, and it doesn't have to be a current member. You can get a number 27 Harold Schneps jersey. You can get a Kirk McLean number 1 jersey, whatever you want. Your choice. Pavel Bure, 10, 90. What was his other number he changed to? 96. McGillney, Dixon Ward, 17, if you want. Your choice. Jack Mack. What number were you, Jack Mack? 29? All right, 17 it is. You get access to the post-game press conference. Hopefully it's a winning game so Travis can say some good things to everybody. Game to be determined by both parties. Whatever it is that you want, Kirk will make sure Trevor does it. So where do we want to start at, Grant? $1,500. Are those game-worn jerseys? Yes. Let's start at $1,000. We'll work our way up. We'll guilt somebody. $1,000 over there. $1,250. $1,500. $1,750. $1,750. Thanks, Jim. Let's go to $2,000. $2,000 over there. $2,250. $2,250. $2,500. They're just thinking about that case of Crown Royal. I know that group. $2,750. $2,750. $3,000. Let's get this to $3,000, and we'll make Trevor come in and do cartwheels for you. What's that? We got three. We need $3,250. Who's got $3,250? $3,250. $3,500. Let's go to $3,500. $3,500, $3,750. Good thing Trevor ain't here. We're promising the world. Hey, Patty, start making those beds in the back room. We can get some blow up ones from Canadian Tire. We're good. Where are we at? $3,750? $3,750. At $4,000. What's that? We're out there. Who's the $4,000 here? Trust me, we're gonna make it worth more than $4,000. Like I said, $4,000 there. $4,250, $4,250, $4,500. Where are we at? Who's at $4,250? Who's at, Jimmy, who's at $4,250?
We're at 45.
We're at 45. Who's at, anybody at $4,750? Thanks, tips. First rodeo. Who's at 4,500? There, where's your other 4,250? 2 at 4,500, we're gonna take him, and Trevor's gonna love it. He'll pick you up in his limo for sure. 2 at 4,500, take it 4,500. Trust me, Kirk will come and serve you wine. He'll put an apron on, he'll cook you some appetizers. 45? Jimmy, get some work. We got some 2 here. 2 at 45. Okay, we'll make Trevor mail. Send him an email, 4,500, 2 packages. Thank you very much. So. Jesus. That was a hell of an idea you had, yeah. Woo! Who would have thought to sell 2? can do whatever you want. You're the one who's been married to Willie Mitchell. That is a very tough job. However, you didn't get him on time last night, so we got to talk. So, last one. Willie, you'll be interested in this one. Sturgeon fishing. As we all know, you're a big fisherman from the island, and also we know by Googling you, you've made a few bucks over the years, so start bidding. Sturgeon fishing for 2 days. Now, Bruce, I have to ask you something, if you can, if you're awake, where are you? Is this one person or two people? It's for three. It's for, I forgot that Grant's name was Bruce. Three, how many people for one package? Three? You're as confused as I am. It says one on my paper, so I just double checking, like, who's going by themselves? Who's the loser going by themselves? I don't know. I'll start debating at $30. Hey, maybe for 60, Jim Houston, you and I go together. We're in for sure. Okay. Here's the package. One spot for 2 days with NHL stars Andrew Ladd, Blake Wheeler, Tyler Myers, Nick Leddy, Chris Vertig, Dustin Byfuglien, Troy Brower. You're getting generous with the word stars nowadays in the NHL. I was never called a star. I was as good as some of those guys, for sure. Anyway, NHL stars, as they say, excellent people, all of them, and many more. Is there 18 guys or something? 20 NHL guys.
20 NHL guys, one per boat.
And when are they going? July? What, shouldn't they be training? July 31st? And you, and Grant Kladek and Kurt Chamberlain are also going to accompany you on this trip, and they're going to bring you cases of Crown Royal as well. Thank you, the Chamberlain Group, for that donation. So July 31st, August 3rd, 2018 or 2019. Okay, Fraser River Lodge and Tall Timbers in Agassiz. The value is $5,000. It will be a hoot with these guys because Dustin Byfuglien would be a hoot no matter what you did.
Everything's paid for,
100% of everything and more. So the value is $5,000. Where do we want to start, Grant? $2,500. Who's in for $2,500? Fishing, catching big sturgeon. Hanging out with the boys. These guys got lots of stories because they could hide out. Nobody knows who they are, so they do all kinds of stuff without being recognized, right? In the Roxy, they can go in the Roxy and nobody knows them. It's great. They'll give you lots of stories. You like that, Dale? I'm a piece of work. I've never been said. It's the first time I ever heard that. So, $2,500. Let's get a fishing trip going. Let's get this going. Who's got $1,500 going on a fishing trip with the NHL guys? Grant and Kurt, drinking, eating, catching big fish. Anybody? We got $1,500? $2,000? Anybody got $2,000? $2,000? Who else we got? You know what? Let's make it two people. Like, let's just be smart here. Like, sorry, honey, I gotta go fishing. Two people. So you take your buddy. Two people, $3,000. Where are we at? $3,000, two people, 2 days fishing, sturgeon, eating, drinking, staying overnight, telling stories, lying about everything we all lie about. Barry Petrochenko, you want to go fishing, don't you? Probably not. You and Jeremy can go fishing, catch some big sturgeon. Yeah. Where are we at? Nobody wants to go fishing, Jim. Okay, let's get it done. $2,000? Two for $2,000? Who's got, what do we got over here? How much? $3,000? $2,500 for how many people? $2,500 for two people. Do we got $3,000 for two people going once? $3,000 for two people. We got $3,000. You want to go? Hey, come on. You got lots of money. $3,500, two people. $3,500, $4,000. $4,000. Jim, can you explain to me what's going on back there? How much? $4,000, two people. Who's going? You going to 4,500? You just went, the same guy went from 4 to 4, 45? Woohoo! That's for one person, right? $4,000 for two? Four people. I can't. Well, I don't have that kind of power. I don't know. Andrew Ladd, how many people in the boat?
Three and a player.
Three and a player, but how many boats they got? Can we just throw a whole bunch of shit in and see what they say? Let's just do it. How many you want? You want to do two? $4,000. You want to do $4,000? We'll do two packages. You're done. $4,000, $4,000, two each. Done deal. Thank you very much. I hope there's room on that river. Thank you all very much. Enjoy your evening. Congratulations, Willie. Thank you to your lovely wife for your help. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dixon. Thanks to all our donors. That's awesome. Before we get to our list of inductees, when you all sat down at your tables, you saw one of these waiting for you. And it goes without saying what it represents. But the Burnaby Lakers hockey team wants to send a special thank you out to Daniel Barwell, who's directed to the House of Stitches in Humboldt, Saskatchewan. That's where all of these have been made. And Danielle's the niece of our Jack and Christy Cooney. She lives in Regina. She was a close friend of Dana Braun's. That was the young athletic therapist who lost her life in the bus accident. The House of Stitches has been supplying these ribbons with 100% of the proceeds going to various Humboldt Bronco causes. Danielle is requesting that the Lakers contribute funds for the ribbons to the Dana Braun Scholarship Fund at Mount Royal University, where she's a graduate from. So if any of you would like to make a donation, either tonight or when you leave, maybe tomorrow or at any time, there's been a scholarship fund set up through the Mount Royal University website. So please keep that in mind when you leave this evening, because this means a lot to a lot of people. Our first inductee tonight goes in as a team from the Lower Mainland formed in the late 1970s. Now, never before had a team from that part of our province had won the Hardy Cup, which, for those of you who are not aware, was Canada's top hockey prize for Intermediate A hockey. But in the spring of 1980, the Burnaby Lakers took home the championship, and they were able to do it in their own backyard. Take a look at the video screens to learn more about the Burnaby Lakers.
First thing that I think about is what a big family we were.
Just a total team. We were all good friends.
On and off the ice, along with our
girlfriends. A lot of guys were married at that time, but the tightest-knit team I've ever been a part of.
In 2003, this team was honored by their city as the Burnaby Sports Hall of Fame recognized the accomplishments of the 1979-1980 Lakers. The senior men's hockey team were the defending North Shore League and playoff champs, but that wasn't enough as they did what no other Lower Mainland team and only two other BC teams did before, win the Canadian Intermediate A Hockey Championship Hardy Cup. The Lakers defeated teams from Burnaby, Prince Rupert, and Port Alberni on their way to a Koi Cup championship. From there, they would defeat Alberta's Innisfail Eagles and Saskatchewan's Asquith Canadians to win the Western Canadian title. Next up were the Eastern-winning Fredericton Capitals, and the Lakers showed their strength as they won three games over 3 days in late April at the Pacific Coliseum to capture the 1980 Hardy Cup. Now the province takes notice as the 1979-80 Burnaby Lakers enter the BC Hockey Hall of Fame.
Had a chance to meet a few of these gentlemen last night up at the winery. They're pumped to be here, many of which haven't seen each other in quite some time. Tonight, Hockey Night in Canada broadcaster and a member of the Hall, Jim Houston, is back with us. Want to call Jim up to the stage. He's going to make the presentation for our first inductee into the class of 2018. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome up the members of the 1980 Burnaby Lakers Hardy Cup Championship team, and their spokesperson tonight will be Gary Forbes. Come on up, guys, to the stage.
Okay, we tried to get Jim to do the speech, but I guess I'm stuck. This is just about the biggest dressing room I've ever had to address. Thanks, Jim, and good evening, everyone. Before I begin, I'd like to give special acknowledgement to two of our players that are no longer with us, defenseman Dave Duck and our trainer, equipment manager, Cyril Cave. Cease is represented by his sons, Brandon and Ron. Now, I know a lot of people didn't know too much about us, so I'll give you a little background. For the group standing here behind me, the journey is almost over. The journey began in 1964, 54 years ago. A group of young men known as the Burnaby Sports Club decided to enter a recreational hockey league. Jack Cooney was a member of the Burnaby Sports Club along with a couple of the rest of us, but he is actually the initiator of this whole thing. And he's the founder. So we can blame him for whatever happens. Now, I am a little nervous. We first started playing in the lowest division of the Greater Vancouver Hockey League. And within 3 years, we had moved from the D division and won the A. We were kind of a competitive young group of guys, and we decided we wanted to increase the competitive level. So our next step was to the Richmond Intermediate Hockey League. The first year in the league was 1971. And a young man by the name of David Poyle was the league scoring champion. So I think a lot of you people would know who David Poyle is. Anyway, there were bumps in the road and a huge learning curve. We were playing some serious hockey now. There was trips to Anchorage, Fairbanks, Reno, Nevada, Boise, Idaho. We did a lot of traveling, and we did that to seek out competition. The next step, when the Richmond League folded a couple years later, was to move into the Pacific Northwest Hockey League. This league featured teams from Port Alberni, Powell River, the North Shore Hurricanes. Richmond put one team in, Portland Buckaroos, that had just left the Western Hockey League. And there was a lot of former pros and a few NHL players that played in the league. And the competition was starting to get harder. But it was another step to seek even a higher competition. There were exhibition games against the Prince George Mohawks, the Quesnel Kangaroos, the Kamloops Cowboys, which were the newly formed BC Senior Hockey League. Actually, we did pretty good against them. I was happy. In 1979, our founder, owner, main fundraiser, and my personal good friend, Jack Cooney, approached me and said due to business reasons, he had to drop out. And he asked me if I would take the team over. I did. I gladly accepted. It was an honor for him to consider me. And with my infectious charm and good sense of humor and good hockey sense, I proceeded to put the 79-80 Lakers together. There were a few holdovers, some recent university graduates from the Thunderbirds, a couple of players who flirted with pro hockey, and we needed a league because the Northwest League had folded because of expenses. So we ended up going to the North Shore Intermediate Hockey League. There were several road trips that year because we had to find competition. The North Shore League was a pretty good league, but we wanted to play better. And I guess that was a competitive nature for us. The decision was made that year that we wanted to go as far as we could. We never really thought we'd get as far as we did, but we knew we were a really tight group of guys that just enjoyed each other. We loved hockey. And I honestly cannot recall one argument or bad discussion that whole year. So the battle of BC was the first step, and that was the Koi Cup. You saw how we went through that, and we lost our very first game 6-0 to Vernon, and we went, wow, what's happening? But we came back. Their coach said this game is over in two. I said, yeah, the next two, and that's what it was. I said our average score all year was 8-3. We're going to win 8-3, 8-3. We won 8-3 and 8-4. Not bad. That's the kind of team we had to pull together. After winning the Koi Cup, we advanced to play Innisfail Eagles, and they were very good. They had Freddie Huckle, who was an ex-pro. I think he scored half their goals for them. He was great. But we knocked them off. Four games, 3-1. Two of those games went in a double overtime. It was tough and very good competition. The next team up was Asquith, Saskatchewan, and that was for the Edmonton Journal Cup of Western Canada. We beat them 3 straight, and we thought we were rolling pretty good. The Hardy Cup was coming to the BC West Coast. You gotta love it. The team we played that year was Fredericton Capitals from New Brunswick, coached by 50-goal scorer Danny Grant of the NHL. And the Pacific Coliseum at Renfrew in Vancouver was our new home. We had ambitious thoughts. Anyway, the unlikely result was finally accomplished. The Burnaby Lakers became the Hardy Cup champions in 3 straight games. After all the celebrating, there were a few bills to pay. Financial support came from many people. It included rental relief through the support of the then college Coliseum manager, the late Mario Carvetta, and the late Emery Barnes, MLA in Victoria. This also included the players digging in their own pocket for $1,000 to try and cover bills that were unsettled. And that was no mean feat, as most of the guys were pretty young guys just starting out in life, some of them just married and everything else. That's how much we love the game. And somebody said, why do you do this? And I said, and it was answered, not by me, because we do love the game. And there's no doubt about it. Years later, here we are today. Induction into the BC Hockey Sports Hall of Fame. Wow. Gentlemen, the journey we started is complete. We went all the way. The entire Burnaby Lakers organization would like to congratulate fellow inductees, Willie Mitchell, Scott Annan, Jerry Sillars, who was a very good player in our league at one time, on their induction to the BC Sports Hockey Hall of Fame. I consider myself to be a very lucky man. 18 years of very competitive amateur hockey, 34 years of Laker old-timers, going to tournaments, having fun. This has created a very large family of lifelong friends, teammates, players, management partners, and my good friend Jack Cooney, who shared my love of hockey and the Burnaby Lakers. I would also like to thank our greatest fans, our wives and girlfriends. They supported us and understood our need to play this game. Without their support, we would never have reached where we are now today. From the bottom of my heart, ladies, thank you very much. We would also like to thank the selection committee for bestowing this great honor on us. And thank you again, everyone, and I hope you enjoy the evening like we're going to.
Well, that's great. That's our first inductee. It's fantastic. I think a lot of us didn't know the Burnaby Lakers story. That's good. I know a lot of the guys who look in fantastic shape were walking by me as they left the stage, and they said, was that okay? Did we go too long? You can never go too long. This is your moment. So don't worry about that. But the wildfires are all now contained. And we want to keep this. Bruce has us going to a strict clock. We want it to be done before sunset. So, Scott, I know you got a World Championship and World Cup, and Willie, a couple of those crazy Stanley Cups. Well, you guys got 30 seconds each when you're up here. When we think of the Canucks alumni, we think of some of the real fan favorites, and plenty of them here today. Harold, Steve Tambellini, Kirk McLean, and our favorite auctioneer, Dixon Ward. Guys who played at the Coliseum or Rogers Arena, and many who've been inducted into the BC Hockey Hall of Fame. Tonight, though, the Hall welcomes as their second inductee an alumni member that might not be a household name to everyone, but has been a driving force for decades to make the Canucks Alumni Association one of the strongest and one of the most respected in all of the National Hockey League. Please take a look at the screens to learn more about the man they call Driller, Jerry Sillars.
For some, being inducted into a Hall of Fame is a once-in-a-lifetime achievement. But for our next inductee, twice is more than nice. Jerry Driller Sillars has been a part of the Vancouver Canucks family since the WHL championship season in 1968-69, and that team was honored by the BC Hockey Hall of Fame back in 2006. Sillars would go on to play three more seasons with the Canucks AHL affiliate, the Rochester Americans, before joining the Canucks alumni, and that is where his hard work and dedication will forever be remembered. In 1989, he became the president of the alumni, a position he held until his retirement in 2017 after 28 years leading the way. Over the years, the Canucks alumni has focused on promoting the game of hockey throughout BC while supporting youth, education, and benevolent causes. In 2015, Sillars, who was also a director and secretary treasurer with the NHL alumni for 14 years, was honored by the NHL Players Association with the presentation of the NHL's Seventh Man Award. Now, 3 years later, another honor for Sillars as he takes his place into the BC Hockey Hall of Fame.
Tonight, one of the all-time fan favorites of the Canucks and a BC Hockey Hall of Fame member, Harold Sneps, is with us to present our next inductee into the class of 2018. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jerry Sillars.
Well, I have to turn this down, but first of all, I want to congratulate the Burnaby Lakers on their induction tonight, and I know most of those guys, and I can imagine the stories that have been told over the last couple of days, and there's probably a few that shouldn't be told, but anyway, congratulations, gentlemen. I also want to congratulate all the other award winners, especially Willie and Scott, for their incredible careers, both on and off the ice, and their induction tonight is most deserving. So congratulations, gentlemen. Now, I must say I feel a little bit awkward up here and nervous because for 28 years I was always on the other side presenting the awards. And the checks to charities and what have you, so please bear with me. But I do want to speak briefly about the long history and the very interesting beginning of the Canuck alumni. Back in the 1950s, there was some former Hall of Famers led by Fred Cyclone Taylor, Neil Colville, Clint Smith, and Walter Bay Pratt. And they decided to host a charity game at the old Pacific PNE Forum. And the purpose of the game was to raise some money to assist the medical expenses for a former player's wife that was seriously ill. And the game was a big success, and they decided to hold the event every other year. Again, raising funds to assist former players that had fallen on difficult times, whether financial or medical. And in 1953, that same group incorporated a nonprofit society called the BC Hockey Benevolent Association. And later in the 1960s, 70s, they sponsored a Canuck Old Timers hockey team that was made up mainly of the former Western Hockey League players and other players living in the Vancouver area. And they would travel the province playing charity games, raising money for minor hockey and other deserving charities in those communities. As the NHL alumni or NHL players retired and became important component or important part of the alumni and the nucleus of the alumni, it eventually was reorganized and renamed the Vancouver Canuck Alumni Association. So that's the long history, and over the years, the alumni has raised over $2-3 million in support of minor hockey, various charities, and several deserving youth charities. Canuck Place has been one of those charities, and has always been had a special place in the heart of both the Vancouver Canucks and the alumni. And recently, there was a new hospice built out in Abbotsford, and to serve those families, in the Fraser Valley and other parts of the province. And in support of the Dave Letty House, the alumni donated $75,000 to finish and furnish an amazing recreation room to be enjoyed by the children and their families. And it's named, it's in the name of the Canuck alumni, which is awesome. Also last year, the Canuck alumni presented a brand new passenger van to Canuck Place, all decorated in Canuck colors and logos, including the inspirational words, "Live in this moment." And that's something that we could all take a lesson from. Also, for many years, the alumni has been a big supporter of the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Vancouver. And a few years ago, with the help of the NHL Players Association and Planet Ice in Coquitlam, the alumni founded a Boys and Girls hockey program. And a group of young boys and girls were fully equipped, including skates, and were provided weekly ice time with Canuck alumni instruction. And a couple of years ago, the Great Pacific Forum in Delta came on board and with additional ice time. And now today the group is over 60 young kids who would never have had the chance to play the game that we all love. So that program has been very special to us. Another charity of choice has been Camp Good Times. The camp is located in the Fraser Valley and is run by the Canadian Cancer Society and offers a fun and recreational experience for young children with cancer. When you think of cancer, you tend to think of the adult community. But having been to the camp and seeing hundreds of kids running around that have been stricken by this dreaded disease is shocking. And over the years, the alumni has provided more than $300,000 in support of this extremely worthwhile cause. These are just a few of the many charities that the alumni supports, and including, of course, the Canuck for Kids Fund and the Canucks Autism Network. The alumni has also been a strong advocate of our youth combining their sport and education. The alumni has and continues to provide financial assistance to both the UBC and the Simon Fraser hockey programs. as well as several other scholarship programs. The Rick Blight Scholarship is in conjunction with the Crisis Center of BC. And the scholarships are presented to young individuals who have made a major commitment to their sport and the community while managing their own mental wellness. The Larry Ashley Scholarship is in conjunction with the Canadian Athletic Therapists Association, and we have several scholarships and bursaries to boys and girls within the Pacific Coast Amateur Hockey Association. The program the alumni is most proud of is in partnership with the BC Hockey League and has provided over $500,000 in scholarship funds to young graduates of the league who have gone on to pursue a post-secondary education while playing hockey at the college level. Obviously, none of this is possible without the support of so many people for so many years. I want to thank first and foremost all the alumni, board members, directors, past and present, and the entire alumni membership for their commitment, their dedication, and their continued support over all these years. Many of the alumni here tonight, and again, a big thank you to you for being here. I want to thank the Canuck ownership and the management. Pat Quinn. When Pat was the GM, he played a major role in taking the alumni to the next level. And right up to his final few weeks, he would call and ask what he could do to help the alumni. Brian Burke. Whenever I had to go ask Berkey for something, it was like walking on eggshells. But whenever you made the ask, he was all in, and he couldn't do enough to help. Same could be said for Davey Nonis, Mike Gillis, and of course Trevor Linden, who continues to support all the alumni's efforts. I want to extend a special thank you to our corporate sponsors, and our many sponsors whose financial support has allowed the Canuck alumni to grow into a major charitable organization that has been recognized throughout the entire National Hockey League, as well as the many businesses and communities in British Columbia. I'm extremely pleased, to have my family here tonight and share this honor. There's Brett and Sean and our three-year-old grandson from Houston, Texas. Jody and Paul here from Winnipeg. And one of the greatest hockey fan ever, and my best friend, our daughter Dale. And of course, my lovely wife Margie, of almost 49 years, who has been an important part of the alumni family for over 40 of those years. I've often said that when you volunteer for something that you truly believe in, you don't ask for or expect anything in return. You just hope that your time and effort is appreciated. And tonight, to be inducted into the BC Hockey Hall of Fame is the ultimate gift of appreciation, and I'm truly thankful. Thank you.
Well done, Jerry. Congratulations. One of the great guys in the Vancouver area and right throughout BC, Jerry getting everything done. We still have two more inductees. Of course, Scott and Willie will be here in a moment, but first, some entertainment. I first saw our next speaker talk. I think it might have been in that 1991 Andy Mo golf tournament. And back then, I started scratching some notes on a napkin. Dennis, I want to apologize. I was stealing the jokes then. I will not do that anymore. I'm just going to hit record on the iPhone, and I won't be scratching anything down. For those of you who don't know Dennis Hull, he was a member of the biggest series there ever was, the 1972 Team Canada Series. If you don't remember that, that's okay. Some of his teammates forget he was there as well. No. Two goals, two assists in the four games. He got it done. He will readily admit to being not being another other than Bobby Hall's brother. He doesn't mind saying that as long as you add it is the younger brother. Also been known as the uncle of Brett Hall, who of course lit it up here in Penticton. He simply is the funniest man to ever play hockey, and you wonder if his true calling was to come and talk to you and make you laugh. The most infectious laugh you will ever hear in the NHL, and one of the best speakers you will ever hear. Get prepared to be entertained. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm round of applause for Dennis Hall.
Thank you very much, whoever you are. It's always good to be introduced by a nobody, eh? That's good. But I do come from a hockey-playing family, as many of you know, obviously. Bobby was just voted the greatest left winger in the first 100 years of the National Hockey League. We're pretty proud of that. And I always report back to Bobby what the response is. So I'll just tell him there was a smattering of applause. And if you watch Brett play, you know that he was absolutely fabulous. That's the good news. The bad news is I'm the third best of that group. I actually would have been fourth best, but they wouldn't let my sister Maxine play. She ended up being a hooker outside the Montreal Forum. As John Beliveau said, she had a lot better chance of scoring there than you did. But I've had a wonderful retirement over the years, and just a couple of years ago, I joined the Big Brothers and Sisters, a wonderful organization. And every Sunday, an 80-year-old guy comes and takes me for a walk. He said, if you're a good boy, I might take you to the zoo. But I played before they made a lot of money, just like Caesar and all of the guys, older guys. And Bobby and I just have the one set of hair. If Bobby has it tonight, I'm not even sure he's getting married. But talking about married, my wife is here somewhere. Where are you, Janet? Where are you, dear? Yeah, Janet just turned 60 in January, very traumatic time for her. And she asked me, she said, have you ever slept with a 60-year-old? I said, no, but I slept with 30-year-old twins. She said, were they identical? And I said, no, the brother had a mustache. Stop it. But I do come from a large family. I have 8 sisters and 3 brothers, and never slept alone until I got married. But but as many of you know, and as was mentioned by my very poor introduction. This year was the 45th anniversary of Team Canada 72. And for some strange reason, you'll know now why he's not that smart, President Putin was 17 years old in 1972. And his favorite player was me. President Putin asked me to fly to Moscow. Last September, I flew to Moscow. We get on his private plane. We flew to Sochi. And this is the ring that President Putin gave me. But while we're in Sochi, we had a one. Oh, no, you don't have to clap for that. While we're in Sochi, President Putin said, "Dennis, you like Sochi?" I said, "President Putin, this trumps everything." He went, "What?" But we've had so many unbelievable things happen to that team. We got the Queen's Jubilee Medal. We got the star on the Walk of Fame. I had dinner with our wonderful Prime Minister. And one of the guys that was at that dinner was, Bobby and I thought, the greatest Russian player we'd ever seen play, Yakushev. You remember Yakushev, number 15? He was like Eric Nesterenko with talent. He was unbelievable. But because of all the nice things I'd said about Yakushev, he honored and surprised me by doing something Russians reserve for best friends. He kissed me on both cheeks, and I'm honored. I know it's a Russian custom. I was surprised, however, because I was tying my shoes at the time. But a lot of the players here were realize that in September every year they have the NHLPA's annual dinner in Toronto at the Marriott Hotel. And I was, I don't know if you'd call it lucky, but I was sitting next to Gary Bettman, right? And, you know, I'm just trying to make conversation with Mr. Bettman. And I said, "You know, Mr. Bettman, I have a brother, Gary," which I do. But he said, I said, "He's got two R's in his name." Mr. Bettman said, "That's redundant, ridiculous, and highly unnecessary." I said, "Well, sir, if my brother loses an R, he's still Gary. What are you?" I don't think I'm going back again next year. But I get a chance to see a lot of former players like Caesar and all these guys tonight. And last July, I was on my way out to Vancouver. And, you know, I got on the flight, and it's a long flight, and I took my shoes off. And sitting next to me, Dave the Hammer Schultz, right? Toughest guy I had ever played against. Pretty nervous, closest I'd ever been to him. He spit in both of my shoes. Like, what am I going to do? I'm a Lady Bing guy. So halfway to Vancouver, he said, "Hey, Hulk, get me a Coke." "Oh, Jesus, what am I going to do?" I went and got him a Coke. And we're getting off the flight, and I said, "You know, Dave, we have to stop acting like stupid hockey players and join regular society and not do these stupid things." He said, "What do you mean?" I said, "You know, spitting in the shoes, pissing in the Coke." But they're talking all the time now about concussions, and rightly so, I guess, but... you know, I played 14 years, and nobody on our team ever had a concussion. And maybe I'll tell you why. Our doctor was Dr. Tremaine. He was 95. He had prematurely blue hair, and he was a gynecologist. He was Mr. Wirtz's brother-in-law. But no one had a concussion, but luckily no one got pregnant either, so that was good. Doctor's obviously a lot better now, and our doctor in Coburg, where Janet and I go every year for annual checkup, Dr. Mark Isak, wonderful man, and went there last November before we headed out west, and he said, "Any problems?" And I said, "Yeah, well, just a bit of an earache." He said, "Take all your clothes off and stand in front of the window." I said, "Mark, I got an earache." He said, "I know, but I hate my neighbor." he said, any other problems? And I said, well, I think old Janet's going deaf. He said, really? Well, before we do some big, long tests, he said, you go home and find her maybe cooking at the stove and get 15 feet behind her and say something, then 10, and then 5. So I went home, and Janet's at the stove cooking. I got 15 feet behind her, and I said, what's for dinner? Nothing. I got 10 feet behind her, and I said, what's for dinner? Nothing. I got 5 feet behind her, and I said, what's for dinner? She turned around and said, for the third time, meatloaf. Hi, darling. How are you? Would you like to be Brett Hull's aunt? You'd be Bobby Hull's sister-in-law. Isn't she a cutie? Anyway, on my 65th birthday years ago, Janet took me to Las Vegas. And I'm sure you've all been to a casino in Las Vegas similar to that. And I bet you've never noticed on the blackjack table, there's an indiscreet sign that says, if you have a gambling problem, call 1-800-GAMBLE. So I called. I said, listen, I got a jack and a six. The bastards hung up on me. But 65 is a big year for all of us, I guess. But my big year for me was 66. You want to know why? 66. And Caesar can attest to this. Our goalie in Chicago, the great Glenn Hall, he's got a little bit of a lisp. Right, Caesar? So we had training camp in St. Catharines, and there was a sign as you left when we went out to play exhibition games, Toronto, 66 miles. So I'd say, I wonder how far it is to Toronto. And Glenn would say, 66th mile. And being from Humboldt, Saskatchewan, it was the fourth time before he figured it out. He said, 132 return, you smart aleck bastard. So as you can imagine, I can't wait to turn 66, which I did on November 19th, and Bobby was in my kitchen with Dale Talon and Jim Pappin, and I phoned Glenn Hall in Stony Plain, Alberta. I said, hi, Glenn, it's Dennis. He said, yes, I know. I said, Glenn, it's my birthday. He said, yes, I know. I said, how old am I, Glenn? He said, 110 kilometers. The bastard wouldn't say 66. But Janet and I were just in Regina a couple weeks ago, and you ladies might be interested in this. I got her a sheepdog brassier. Have you heard of those? Rounds them up and points them in the right direction. But Bobby just turned 79 on January the 3rd, and like a good brother, I got him a nice gift. Although we are the highest scoring brothers in the history of professional hockey, both on and off the ice. And I wasn't much help at either place. But I got him a nice strobe light. That's a good gift, right? He said he put it in his bedroom, actually looks like he's moving. But he was telling me since he's been 79, he has red eyes after sex. He said, what do you think it is? And I said, maybe the mace, Bobby, I don't know. But, you know, I'm lucky to go lots of different places, and I used to have a place in Myrtle Beach. Anybody ever been to Myrtle Beach, South Carolina? Yeah. I have a friend down there who has five first names, Billy Ray, Joe, Bob, Danny, right? he's a strange guy. He goes to Hooters for the food. But I was flying out of, and they don't have regular airlines, out of Myrtle Beach. And I was on Discount Air. And I was on flight 5050. I said to the girl, 60-40, give us a chance. But the captain was a real hockey fan, came back and had a beer with me, and I said, are you allowed to drink back here? He said, oh yeah, I can drink back here, I just can't drink up front, so. But you know, we're flying out of Myrtle Beach, and I have a window seat, and in the middle seat is a young lady with a brand new baby. And, you know, she's feeding the baby in the natural way. And, you know, what am I going to do? I'm looking out the window. I hated it. Anyway, the stewardess came by and said, what would you like for lunch, Mr. Hall? And I said, same as the kid. She said, you'll have to come up in the galley. But you know, coming from a family of 12, my father was not a big fan of mine. And in fact, actually he didn't know my name. He just called me boy. And he never wanted me to be a hockey player. Honest to God, he wanted me to be a jockey or a gigolo. Huh? I was too small for one and too big for the other one. You figure that one out. Now, he was a nice guy. I remember as a kid, he invited Jehovah's Witness into the house one day, had the guy sit down, said to the guy, what do we do now? The guy says, I don't know. I've never got in before. But in 1961, when the Blackhawks won the Stanley Cup all those many years ago, I was 16 years old in Belleville, Ontario, and my dad made me join the Canadian Army Survival Course. It was put on by the regular Canadian Army. You got $40 a week. It was a six-week course. Wore the uniform, the putties, the boots, everything. I loved it. You can decide whether it did me any good, because we did everything the Army guys did. Pinnacle Avenue in Belleville behind the armories, I'm in charge of the motor pool. The phone rang and the voice said, send a Jeep around the front. I said, sir, we have no Jeeps. He said, send a Jeep around to the front. I said, sir, the only Jeep we have is Fat Boy Colonel Brown's. Well, the voice goes quiet and finally he said, do you know who this is? And I said, no, sir. He said, this is Colonel Brown. I said, do you know who this is? He said, no. I said, see ya, fat boy. As I mentioned, you know, I never made any money in the NHL. We didn't make any money. But my nephew, Brett, 17 years, $5 million a year he averaged. They make a big deal about that. But 71 of the Blackhawks, I signed a contract for $10 million. Just couldn't get them to sign it, but... But I found out at Brett's retirement what it means to have money. A bunch of his friends, Gretzky and all those guys, they had a golf tournament down in Arizona. And I'm with Brett in this great big car, and we're pulling into the parking lot, and a kid in a Porsche pulled right in front of him, took his parking spot. And the kid said, got out and said, you gotta be fast to do that. Brett backed up 50 feet, turned the Porsche into an accordion, and Brett said, you gotta be rich to do that. But Janet and I, we have a farm and raise purebred Polled Herefords. Familiar with Polled Herefords? They're beef cattle. They're red with a white face, sort of the opposite of me. And I'm at my barn every morning at dawn, don't come home till dusk. And one day Janet said, I think you love those cows more than me. I said, yeah, but I love you more than the chickens. Not a good thing to say. She's very upset with me. So I thought, you know, I've never given my Janet a nickname. So before I went to the barn, I said, see a hollyhock. Do you know hollyhocks? Tall, beautiful flower. You don't know hollyhocks? Yeah, you know hollyhocks. Anyway, I come home that night and I said, hi, hollyhock. She said, oh, hollyhock, yeah. I said, what's the matter? She said, I looked up hollyhock in my gardening book. I said, yeah, what's it say? She said, no good in beds, but great up against the garage. Can't win, huh? But I bet you, like all of you guys, we stick with our wives, doesn't matter what happened. And 2 years ago, Janet got picked up for shoplifting. You know, I shouldn't be, I'm telling you anyway, but anyway. I went to court with her, and the judge said, well, my dear, what did you shoplift? And she said, a can of peaches. He said, how many peaches were in the can? She said, four. He said, okay, I'm going to give you 4 days in jail. I said, just a minute, judge. I was with her. I think she stole a can of peas, too. But you know, I had a chance to stay in hockey 30 years ago. Is that the first year the Sharks came into the league? Yeah, I think 30 years ago. Anyway, I got the job as color commentator. I'm flying out to, flew out to San Francisco. I'm driving down Highway 1 because, like, I'm not splitting atoms in my spare time, eh? And I think I'm working for San Jose. It's J-O-S-E, right? So I was driving like Bobby got pulled over. Policeman said, where are you going in such a hurry? I said, down to San Jose. He said, you a hockey player? I said, yeah, how did you know? Well, he said, stupid. California, you don't pronounce a J. It's San Jose. Well, I said, I'm sorry, sir. He said, how long are you going to be here anyway? I said, Union, you lie. But you know, I left the National Hockey League and went to the Illinois Institute of Technologies. Tell me when you've had enough of this, and I'll stop. And it's right across from White Sox Park, engineers and architects. You know, we don't have a lot of great athletes, and actually we only have like four pitchers, and some of them can't get there till the fifth inning because they're in classes. Anyway, we had one guy on our team, honest to God, he walked eight in a row. I got to take him out, right? I got to. So I went out and he said, don't take me out. I said, what? He said, don't take me out. I said, why not? He says, I got a no-hitter going. I went to take another little kid out, and he said, don't take me out. I struck this guy out last time. I said, I know, but it was this inning. I love going to the mound. I went out, and the kid said, don't take me out. I'm not tired. I said, I know, son, but the outfielders are. Oh, boy. But I bet you every guy, every NHL guy or any guy in here can tell you about their first ever game in the NHL. And I'm just going to end by telling you about my first ever game in the NHL. It's against the Detroit Red Wings. It's against my all-time hockey hero, Gordie Howe. It's the third NHL game I've ever been to. It's the first one I've gotten into for free. And it's the best seat I've ever had at a game. I'm in between the defensemen and forwards. You know what that means, Jim? I ain't playing. But, you know, some guys have only played 2-3 games. Some guys only one game. I don't know how many games I'm going to play. I'm making the most of this. I put my glove over the boards, right? Stan Mikita come by, I touch him. Pierre Plott, I touch him. Alex Delvecchio, I touch him. Bobby Hogaby, I touch him. Honest to God, I'm having the best time ever. Until I got this persistent tap on the back. And I pressed the hand away a couple of times. Finally realized it was my coach, Billy Ray. I said, what do you want? He said, get out there and watch Gordie Howe. I said, I can see him fine from here. That was my introduction to the National Hockey League. You guys have been great. Thanks so much.
Dennis Hall, everybody. I do that now? Yeah. Perfect. All right, tough to follow that. We're going to try. Two housekeeping items. Silent auction is going to close in 5 minutes. Extending it. So if you need to check your bids, make sure you're not outbid. Go ahead. If you got a 50-50 ticket, grab it out of your pocket.
What's a combo? The split.
$865. Wow. If you have ticket Staples, hang on here. Here it is. 5174624. Can we have the house lights up? They can't see the tickets. That Burnaby Lakers team can't see the tickets. 5174624. And if you have the ticket, you're going to see Bruce Judd in the back. We get the house lights up there real quick. Perfect. Scrambling now. All right. Let there be light. 5174624. Who has it? You have it? You've got your winnings already? Thank you very much. You're waving all that cash. Congratulations. Before we get to our final two inductees,